A Sappho of Green Springs. By Bret Harte. Podcast 2 of 2. Chapter 4. When the stage for San Francisco rolled away the next morning with Mr. Hamlin and the editor, the latter might have recognized in the occupant of a dust-covered buggy that was coming leisurely towards them the tall figure, long beard, and straight duster of his late visitor, Mr. James Bowers. For Mr. Bowers was on the same quest that the others had just abandoned. Like Mr. Hamlin, he had been left to his own resources, but Mr. Bowers' resources were a lifelong experience and technical skill. He too had noted the topographical indications of the poem, and his knowledge of the Silva of Upper California pointed as unerringly as Mr. Hamlin's luck to the cryptogamous haunts of the summit. Such abnormal growths were indicative of certain localities only, but, as they were not remunerative from a pecuniary point of view, were to be avoided by the sagacious woodman. It was clear, therefore, that Mr. Bowers' visit to Green Springs was not professional, and that he did not even figuratively accept the omen. He baited and rested his horse at the hotel, where his bucolic exterior, however, did not elicit that attention which had been accorded to Mr. Hamlin's charming insolence or the editor's cultivated manner. But he glanced over a township map on the walls of the reading room, and took note of the names of the owners of different lots, farms, and ranches, passing that of Delatour with the others. Then he drove leisurely in the direction of the woods, and, reaching them, tied his horse to a young sapling in the shade, and entered their domain with a shambling but familiar woodman's step. It is not the purpose of this brief chronicle to follow Mr. Bowers in his professional diagnosis of the locality. He recognized nature in one of her moods of wasteful extravagance, a waste that his experienced eye could tell was also sapping the vitality of those outwardly robust shafts that rose around him. He knew, without testing them, that half of these fair-seeming columns were hollow and rotten at the core. He could detect the chill odor of decay through the hot balsamic spices stirred by the wind that streamed through their long aisles like incense mingling with the exhalations of a crypt. He stopped now and then to part the heavy fronds down to their roots in the dank moss, seeing again, as he had told the editor, the weird second twilight through their miniature stems, and the microcosm of life that filled it. But, even while paying this tribute to the accuracy of the unknown poetess, he was, like his predecessor, haunted more strongly by the atmosphere and melody of her verse. Its spell was upon him, too. Unlike Mr. Hamlin, he did not sing. He only halted once or twice, silently combing his straight narrow beard with his three fingers, until the action seemed to draw down the lines of his face into limitless dejection, and an inscrutable melancholy filled his small gray eyes. The few birds which had hailed Mr. Hamlin as their successful rival fled away before the grotesque and angular half-length of Mr. Bowers, as if the wind had blown in a scarecrow from the distant farms. Suddenly he observed the figure of a woman, with her back towards him, leaning motionless against a tree, and apparently gazing intently in the direction of Green Springs. He had approached so near to her that it was singular she had not heard him. Mr. Bowers was a bashful man in the presence of the other sex. He felt exceedingly embarrassed. If he could have gone away without attracting her attention, he would have done so. Neither could he remain silent, a tacit spy of her meditation. He had recourse to a polite but singularly artificial cough. To his surprise, she gave a faint cry, turned quickly towards him, and then shrank back and lapsed quite helpless against the tree. Her evident distress overcame his bashfulness. He ran towards her. "I'm sorry I frightened ye, ma'am, but I was afraid I might scare ye more if I lay low, and said nothing." Even then, if she had been some fair young country girl, he would have relapsed after this speech into his former bashfulness. But the face and figure she turned towards him were neither young nor fair, a woman past 40, with gray threads and splashes in her brushed back hair, which was turned over her ears in two curls like frayed strands of rope. Her forehead was rather high than broad, her nose large but well shaped, and her eyes full but so singularly light in color as to seem almost sightless. The short upper lip of her large mouth displayed her teeth in an habitual smile, which was in turn so flatly contradicted by every other line of her careworn face that it seemed gratuitously artificial. Her figure was hidden by a shapeless garment that partook equally of the shawl, cloak, and wrapper. "I am very foolish," she began, in a voice and accent that at once asserted a cultivated woman, "but I so seldom meet anybody here that a voice quite startled me. That, and the heat," she went on, wiping her face, into which the color was returning violently, "for I seldom go out as early as this, I suppose, affected me." Mr. Bowers had that innate far western reverence for womanhood which I fancy challenges the most polished politeness. He remained patient, undemonstrative, self-effacing, and respectful before her, his angular arm slightly but not obtrusively advanced, the offer of protection being in the act rather than in any spoken word, and requiring no response. "Like as not, ma'am," he said, cheerfully looking everywhere but in her burning face. "The sun is powerful hot at this time o' day, I felt it myself come in yer, and, though the damp of this timber kinder sets it back, it's likely to come out a g'in. Ye can't check it no more than the sap in that choked limb thar." He pointed ostentatiously where a fallen pine had been caught in the bent and twisted arm of another, but which still put out a few green tassels beyond the point of impact. "Do you live far from here, ma'am?" he added. "Only as far as the first turning below the hill. I've got my buggy here, and I'm going that way, and I can just set ye down thar cool and comfortable. F," he continued, in the same assuring tone, without waiting for a reply, "ye'll just take a good grip of my arm thar," curving his wrist and hand behind him like a shepherd's crook, "I'll go first, and break away the brush for ye." She obeyed mechanically, and they fared on through the thick ferns in this fashion for some moments, he looking ahead, occasionally dropping a word of caution or encouragement, but never glancing at her face. When they reached the buggy he lifted her into it carefully and perpendicularly, it struck her afterwards, very much as if she had been a transplanted sapling with bared and sensitive roots, and then gravely took his place beside her. "Been in the timber trade myself, ma'am," he said, gathering up the reins, "I chanced to sight these woods, and took a look around. My name is Bowers, of Mendocino. I reckon there ain't much that grows in the way o' standin' timber on the Pacific slope that I don't know and can't locate, though I do say it. I've got easy big a mill, and easy big a run in my district, easy there is anywhere. If you're ever up my way, you ask for Bowers Jim Bowers and that's me. There is probably nothing more conducive to conversation between strangers than a wholesome and early recognition of each other's foibles." Mr. Bowers, believing his chance acquaintance a superior woman, naively spoke of himself in a way that he hoped would reassure her that she was not compromising herself in accepting his civility, and so satisfy what must be her inevitable pride. On the other hand, the woman regained her self-possession by this exhibition of Mr. Bowers' vanity, and, revived by the refreshing breeze caused by the rapid motion of the buggy along the road, thanked him graciously. "I suppose there are many strangers at the Green Springs Hotel," she said, after a pause. "I didn't get to see 'em, as I only put up my hoss there," he replied. "But I know the stage took some away this morning, it seemed pretty well loaded up when I passed it." The woman drew a deep sigh. The act struck Mr. Bowers as a possible return of her former nervous weakness. Her attention must at once be distracted at any cost, even conversation. "Perhaps," he began, with sudden and appalling lightness, "I may talk into Mrs. McFadden." "No," said the woman, abstractedly. "Then it must be Mrs. Delatour? There are only two township lots on that crossroad." "My name is Delatour," she said, somewhat wearily. Mr. Bowers was conversationally stranded. He was not at all anxious to know her name, yet, knowing it now, it seemed to suggest that there was nothing more to say. He would, of course, have preferred to ask her if she had read the poetry about the underbrush, and if she knew the poetess, and what she thought of it, but the fact that she appeared to be an educated woman made him sensitive of displaying technical ignorance in his manner of talking about it. She might ask him if it was subjective or objective, two words he had heard used at the debating society at Mendocino on the question, "Is poetry morally beneficial?" For a few moments he was silent. but presently she took the initiative in conversation, at first slowly and abstractedly, and then, as if appreciating his sympathetic reticence, or mayhap finding some relief in monotonous expression, talked mechanically, deliberately, but unostentatiously about herself. So colorless was her intonation that at times it did not seem as if she was talking to him, but repeating some conversation she had held with another. She had lived there ever since she had been in California. Her husband had bought the Spanish title to the property when they first married. The property at his death was found to be greatly involved. She had been obliged to part with much of it to support her children, four girls and a boy. She had been compelled to withdraw the girls from the convent at Santa Clara to help about the house. The boy was too young, she feared, too shiftless to do anything. The farm did not pay, the land was poor, she knew nothing about farming, she had been brought up in New Orleans, where her father had been a judge, and she didn't understand country life. Of course she had been married too young, as all girls were. Lately she had thought of selling off and moving to San Francisco, where she would open a boarding house or a school for young ladies. He could advise her, perhaps, of some good opportunity. Her own girls were far enough advanced to assist her in teaching. One particularly, Cynthia, was quite clever, and spoke French and Spanish fluently. As Mr. Bowers was familiar with many of these counts in the feminine American indictment of life generally, he was not perhaps greatly moved. But in the last sentence he thought he saw an opening to return to his main object, and, looking up cautiously, said, "And mebbe write poetry now and then." To his great discomfiture, the only effect of this suggestion was to check his companion's speech for some moments and apparently throw her back into her former abstraction. Yet, after a long pause, as they were turning into the lane, she said, as if continuing the subject, "I only hope that, whatever my daughters may do, they won't marry young." The yawning breaches in the Delatour gates and fences presently came in view. They were supposed to be reinforced by half a dozen dogs, who, however, did their duty with what would seem to be the prevailing inefficiency, retiring after a single perfunctory yelp to shameless stretching, scratching, and slumber. Their places were taken on the veranda by two Negro servants, two girls respectively of 8 and 11, and a boy of 14, who remained silently staring. As Mr. Bowers had accepted the widow's polite invitation to enter, she was compelled, albeit in an equally dazed and helpless way, to issue some preliminary orders. "Now, Chloe, I mean Aunt Dinah, do take Eunice, I mean Victorine and Una away, and you know tidy them, and you, Sarah, it's Sarah, isn't it, lay some refreshment in the parlor for this gentleman. And, Bob, tell your sister Cynthia to come here with Eunice." As Bob still remained staring at Mr. Bowers, she added, in weary explanation, "Mr. Bowers brought me over from the Summit Woods in his buggy, it was so hot. There, shake hands and thank him, and run away do." They crossed a broad but scantily furnished hall. Everywhere the same look of hopeless incompleteness, temporary utility, and premature decay. Most of the furniture was mismatched and misplaced, many of the rooms had changed their original functions or doubled them. A smell of cooking came from the library, on whose shelves, mingled with books, were dresses and household linen, and through the door of a room into which Mrs. Delatour retired to remove her duster, Mr. Bowers caught a glimpse of a bed, and of a table covered with books and papers, at which a tall, fair girl was writing. In a few moments Mrs. Delatour returned, accompanied by this girl, and Eunice, her short-lipped sister. Bob, who joined the party seated around Mr. Bowers and a table set with cake, a decanter, and glasses, completed the group. Emboldened by the presence of the tall Cynthia and his glimpse of her previous literary attitude, Mr. Bowers resolved to make one more attempt. "I suppose these here young ladies sometimes go to the wood, too." As his eye rested on Cynthia, she replied, "Oh, yes. I reckon on account of the putty shadows down in the brush, and the soft light, and all that," he continued, with a playful manner but a serious accession of color. "Why, the woods belong to us. It's Mars' property, broke in Eunice with a flash of teeth. "Well, Lordy, I want to know," said Mr. Bowers, in some astonishment. "Why, that's right in my line, too. I been siding timber all along here, and that's how I dropped in on your march." Then, seeing a look of eagerness light up the faces of Bob and Eunice, he was encouraged to make the most of his opportunity. "Why, ma'am," he went on, cheerfully, "I reckon you're holding that wood at a pretty stiff figure, now." "Why?" asked Mrs. Delatour, simply. Mr. Bowers delivered a wink at Bob and Eunice, who were still watching him with anxiety. "Well, not on account of the actual timber, for the best of it ain't sound," he said, "but on account of its being famous. Everybody that reads that powerful pretty poem about it in the Excelsior magazine wants to see it. Why, it would pay the Green Springs hotel keeper to buy it up for his customers. But I suppose you reckon to keep it along with the poetess in your family." Although Mr. Bowers long considered this speech as the happiest and most brilliant effort of his life, its immediate effect was not, perhaps, all that could be desired. The widow turned upon him a restrained and darkening face. Cynthia half rose with an appealing "Oh, Mar," and Bob and Eunice, having apparently pinched each other to the last stage of endurance, retired precipitately from the room in a prolonged giggle. "I have not yet thought of disposing of the summit woods, Mr. Bowers," said Mrs. Delatour, coldly, "but if I should do so, I will consult you. You must excuse the children, who see so little company, they are quite unmanageable when strangers are present. Cynthia, will you see if the servants have looked after Mr. Bowers' horse? You know Bob is not to be trusted." There was clearly nothing else for Mr. Bowers to do but to take his leave, which he did respectfully, if not altogether hopefully. But when he had reached the lane, his horse shied from the unwanted spectacle of Bob, swinging his hat, and apparently awaiting him, from the fork of a wayside sapling. "Haul up, mister. Look here." Mr. Bowers pulled up. Bob dropped into the road, and, after a backward glance over his shoulder, said, "Drive alongside the fence in the shadow." As Mr. Bowers obeyed, Bob approached the wheels of the buggy in a manner half shy, half mysterious. "You want to buy them summit woods, mister? Well, poor APS, sonny. Why," smiled Mr. Bowers, "'cause I'll tell ye suthin. Don't you be fooled into allowing that Cynthia wrote that poetry. She didn't know more an Eunice nor me. Mar kinder let ye think it, cause she don't want folks to think she did it. But Mar wrote that poetry herself, wrote it out o' them thar woods all by herself. Thar's a heap more poetry thar, you bet, and just as good. And she's the one that kin write it, you hear me? That's my Mar, every time. You buy that thar wood, and get Mar to run it for poetry, and you'll make your pile, sure. I ain't lying. You'd better look spry, thar's another feller snoopin' round yer, only he barked up the wrong tree, and thought it was Cynthia, just as you did." "Another feller," repeated the astonished Bowers. "Yes, a riglar sport. He was orful keen on that poetry, too, you bet. So you'd better hump yourself afore somebody else cuts in. Mar got $100 for that poem, from that editor feller and his partner. I reckon that's the riglar price, eh?" he added, with a sudden suspicious caution. "I reckon so," replied Mr. Bowers, blankly. "But look here, Bob. Do you mean to say it was your mother, Bob, who wrote that poem? Are you sure?" "Do ye think I'm lying?" said Bob, scornfully. "Don't I know? Don't I copy 'em out plain for her, so as folks won't know her handwrite? Go away, you're loony." Then, possibly doubting if this latter expression were strictly diplomatic with the business in hand, he added, in half reproach, half apology, "Don't ye see I don't want ye to be fooled into losing your chance o' buying up that summit wood? It's the cold truth I'm telling ye." Mr. Bowers no longer doubted it. Disappointed as he undoubtedly was at first and even self-deceived, he recognized in a flash the grim fact that the boy had stated. He recalled the apparition of the sad-faced woman in the wood, her distressed manner, that to his inexperienced mind now took upon itself the agitated trembling of disturbed mystic inspiration. A sense of sadness and remorse succeeded his first shock of disappointment. "Well, are ye going to buy the woods?" said Bob, eyeing him grimly. "Ye'd better say." Mr. Bowers started. "I shouldn't wonder, Bob," he said, with a smile, gathering up his reins. "Anyhow, I'm coming back to see your mother this afternoon. And meantime, Bob, you keep the first chance for me." He drove away, leaving the youthful diplomatist standing with his bare feet in the dust. For a minute or two the young gentleman amused himself by a few light saltatory steps in the road. Then a smile of scornful superiority, mingled perhaps with a sense of previous slights and unappreciation, drew back his little upper lip, and brightened his mottled cheek. "I'd like ter know," he said, darkly, "what this yer godforsaken famerly would do without me." Chapter 5. It is to be presumed that the editor and Mr. Hamlin mutually kept to their tacit agreement to respect the impersonality of the poetess, for during the next 3 months the subject was seldom alluded to by either. Yet in that period White Violet had sent two other contributions, and on each occasion Mr. Hamlin had insisted upon increasing the honorarium to the amount of his former gift. In vain the editor pointed out the danger of this form of munificence. Mr. Hamlin retorted by saying that if he refused he would appeal to the proprietor, who certainly would not object to taking the credit of this liberality. "As to the risks," concluded Jack, sententiously, "I'll take them, and as far as you're concerned, you certainly get the worth of your money." Indeed, if popularity was an indiction, this had become suddenly true. For the poetess their contribution, without changing its strong local color and individuality, had been an unexpected outburst of human passion, a love song, that touched those to whom the subtler meditative graces of the poetess had been unknown. Many people had listened to this impassioned but despairing cry from some remote and charmed solitude, who had never read poetry before, who translated it into their own limited vocabulary and more limited experience, and were inexpressibly affected to find that they, too, understood it. It was caught up and echoed by the feverish, adventurous, and unsatisfied life that filled that day and time. Even the editor was surprised and frightened. Like most cultivated men, he distrusted popularity. Like all men who believe in their own individual judgment, he doubted collective wisdom. Yet now that his protege had been accepted by others, he questioned that judgment and became her critic. It struck him that her sudden outburst was strained. It seemed to him that in this mere contortion of passion the Sibyl's robe had become rudely disarranged. He spoke to Hamlin, and even approached the tabooed subject. "Did you see anything that suggested the sort of business in that woman, I mean in your pilgrimage, Jack?" "No," responded Jack, gravely. "But it's easy to see she's got hold of some hay-footed fellow up there in the mountains with straws in his hair, and is playing him for all he's worth. You won't get much more poetry out of her, I reckon." It was not long after this conversation that one afternoon, when the editor was alone, Mr. James Bowers entered the editorial room with much of the hesitation and irresolution of his previous visit. As the editor had not only forgotten him, but even dissociated him with the poetess, Mr. Bowers was fain to meet his unresponsive eye and manner with some explanation. "Ye disremember my come in here, Mr. Editor, to ask you the name o' the lady who called herself White Violet, and how you allowed you couldn't give it, but would write and ask for it." Mr. Editor, leaning back in his chair, now remembered the occurrence, but was distressed to add that the situation remained unchanged, and that he had received no such permission. "Never mind that, my lad," said Mr. Bowers, gravely, waving his hand. "I understand all that, but, easy, I've known the lady ever since, and am now visiting her at her house on the summit. I reckon it don't make much matter." It was quite characteristic of Mr. Bowers' smileless earnestness that he made no ostentation of this dramatic retort, nor of the undisguised stupefaction of the editor. Do you mean to say that you have met White Violet, the author of these poems? Repeated the editor. Which her name is Delatour, the widow Delatour E.Z. She has herself give me permission to tell you, continued Mr. Bowers, with a certain abstracted and automatic precision that dissipated any suggestion of malice in the reversed situation. Delatour, a widow, repeated the editor. With five children, continued Mr. Bowers. Then, with unalterable gravity, he briefly gave an outline of her condition and the circumstances of his acquaintance with her. But I reckoned you might have known suthin' o' this, though she never let on you did, he concluded, eyeing the editor with troubled curiosity. The editor did not think it necessary to implicate Mr. Hamlin. He said, briefly, No. Of course, you might not have seen her, said Mr. Bowers, keeping the same grave, troubled gaze on the editor. Of course not, said the editor, somewhat impatient under the singular scrutiny of Mr. Bowers, and I'm very anxious to know how she looks. Tell me, what is she like? She is a fine, powerful, educated woman, said Mr. Bowers, with slow deliberation. Yes, sir, a powerful woman, having grand ideas of her own, and holden to em. He had withdrawn his eyes from the editor, and apparently addressed the ceiling in confidence. But what does she look like, Mr. Bowers, said the editor, smiling. Well, sir, she looks like it. Yes, with deliberate caution I should say, just like it. After a pause, apparently to allow the editor to materialize this ravishing description, he said, gently, are you busy just now? Not very. What can I do for you? Well, not much for me, I reckon, he returned, with a deeper respiration, that was his nearest approach to a sigh, but suthin' perhaps for yourself and another. Are you married? No, said the editor, promptly. Nor engaged to any young lady. With great politeness. No. Well, mebbe you think it a queer thing for me to say, mebbe you reckon you know it easy well easy anybody, but it's my opinion that White Violet is in love with you. With me, ejaculated the editor, in a hopeless astonishment that at last gave way to an incredulous and irresistible laugh. A slight touch of pain passed over Mr. Bowers' dejected face, but left the deep outline set with a rude dignity. It's so, he said, slowly, though, as a young man and a gay feller, ye may think it's funny. No, not funny, but a terrible blunder, Mr. Bowers, for I give you my word I know nothing of the lady and have never set eyes upon her. No, but she has on you. I can't say, continued Mr. Bowers, with sublime naivete, that I'd ever recognize you from her description, but a woman o' that kind don't see with her eyes like you and me, but with all her senses to aunt, and a heap more that ain't senses as we know em. The same eyes that see down through the brush and ferns in the summit woods, the same ears that heard the music of the wind trailin' through the pines, don't see you with my eyes or hear you with my ears. And when she paints you, it's natural for a woman with that powerful mind and grandy days to dip her brush into her heart's blood for warmth and color. You're smiling, young man. Well, go on and smile at me, my lad, but not at her. For you don't know her. When you know her story as I do, when you know she was made a wife afore she ever knew what it was to be a young woman, when you know that the man she married never understood the kind o' critter he was tied to no more than if he'd been a steer yoked to a Morgan colt, when ye know she had children growing up around her afore she had given over bein' a sort of child herself, when ye know she worked and slaved for that man and those children about the house her heart, her soul, and all her powerful mind bane all the time in the woods along with the flickering leaves and the shatters when ye mind she couldn't get the small ways o' the ranch because she had the big ways o' nature that made it, then you'll understand her. Impressed by the sincerity of his visitor's manner, touched by the unexpected poetry of his appeal, and yet keenly alive to the absurdity of an incomprehensible blunder somewhere committed, the editor gasped almost hysterically. But why should all this make her in love with me? Because ye are both gifted, returned Mr. Bowers, with sad but unconquerable conviction, because ye're both, so to speak, in a line o' days and business that draws ye together to lean on each other and trust each other as partners. Not that ye are isically heroical, he went on, with a return to his previous exasperating naivete, though I've heard promise in things of ye, and ye're still young, but in matters o' this kind there is allers one eZHEZ to be looked up to by the other and generally the wrong one. She looks up to you, Mr. Editor, it's part of her potry eZ she looks down inter the brush and sees more than is plain to you and me. Not, he continued, with a courteously deprecating wave of the hand, eZ you hint been kind to her mebbe too kind. For thar's the putty letter you writ her, thar's the perlite, eZ, captivatin' way you had with her gals and that boy hold on. As the editor made a gesture of despairing renunciation, I ain't sayin' you ain't right in keepin' it to yourself and thar's the extry money you sent her every time. Stop. She knows it was extry, for she made a P&O gettin' me to find out the market price o' potry in papers and magazines, and she reckons you've been payin' her 400 per cent above them figures hold on. I ain't saying it ain't free and liberal in you, and I'd have done the same thing, yet she thinks. But the editor had risen hastily to his feet with flushing cheeks. One moment, Mr. Bowers, he said, hurriedly. This is the most dreadful blunder of all. The gift is not mine. It was the spontaneous offering of another who really admired our friend's work, a gentleman who he stopped suddenly. The sound of a familiar voice, lightly humming, was borne along the passage, the light tread of a familiar foot was approaching. The editor turned quickly towards the open door so quickly that Mr. Bowers was fain to turn also. For a charming instant the figure of Jack Hamlin, handsome, careless, and confident, was framed in the doorway. His dark eyes, with their habitual scorn of his average fellow man, swept superciliously over Mr. Bowers, and rested for an instant with caressing familiarity on the editor. Well, sonny, any news from the old girl at the summit? No, hastily stammered the editor, with a half-hysterical laugh. No, Jack. Excuse me a moment. All right, busy, I see. Hasta mañana. The picture vanished, the frame was empty. You see, continued the editor, turning to Mr. Bowers, there has been a mistake. But he stopped suddenly at the ashen face of Mr. Bowers, still fixed in the direction of the vanished figure. Are you ill? Mr. Bowers did not reply, but slowly withdrew his eyes, and turned them heavily on the editor. Then, drawing a longer, deeper breath, he picked up his soft felt hat, and, molding it into shape in his hands as if preparing to put it on, he moistened his dry, grayish lips, and said, gently, Friend o' yours? Yes, said the editor Jack Hamlin. Of course, you know him. Yes. Mr. Bowers here put his hat on his head, and, after a pause, turned round slowly once or twice, as if he had forgotten it, and was still seeking it. Finally he succeeded in finding the editor's hand, and shook it, albeit his own trembled slightly. Then he said, I reckon you're right. There's been a mistake. I see it now. Goodbye. If you're ever up my way, drop in and see me. He then walked to the doorway, passed out, and seemed to melt into the afternoon shadows of the hall. He never again entered the office of the Excelsior magazine, neither was any further contribution ever received from White Violet. To a polite entreaty from the editor, addressed first to White Violet and then to Mrs. Delatour, there was no response. The thought of Mr. Hamlin's cynical prophecy disturbed him, but that gentleman, preoccupied in filling some professional engagements in Sacramento, gave him no chance to acquire further explanations as to the past or the future. The youthful editor was at first in despair and filled with a vague remorse of some unfulfilled duty. But, to his surprise, the readers of the magazine seemed to survive their talented contributor, and the feverish life that had been thrilled by her song, in 2 months had apparently forgotten her. Nor was her voice lifted from any alien quarter, the domestic and foreign press that had echoed her lay seemed to respond no longer to her utterance. It is possible that some readers of these pages may remember a previous chronicle by the same historian wherein it was recorded that the volatile spirit of Mr. Hamlin, slightly assisted by circumstances, passed beyond these voices at the ranch of the Blessed Fisherman, some 2 years later. As the editor stood beside the body of his friend on the morning of the funeral, he noticed among the flowers laid upon his bier by loving hands a wreath of white violets. Touched and disturbed by a memory long since forgotten, he was further embarrassed, as the cortege dispersed in the mission graveyard, by the apparition of the tall figure of Mr. James Bowers from behind a monumental column. The editor turned to him quickly. "I am glad to see you here," he said, awkwardly, and he knew not why. Then, after a pause, "I trust you can give me some news of Mrs. Delatour. I wrote to her nearly 2 years ago, but had no response." "Dar's been no Mrs. Delatour for 2 years," said Mr. Bowers, contemplatively stroking his beard, "and mebbe that's why. She's been for 2 years Mrs. Bowers." "I congratulate you," said the editor, "but I hope there still remains a white violet, and that, for the sake of literature, she has not given up." "Mrs. Bowers," interrupted Mr. Bowers, with singular deliberation, "found that makin' potry and tendin' to the cares of a growin' up famerly was irritatin' to the narves. They didn't jibe, so to speak. What Mrs. Bowers wanted and what, potry or no potry, I've been tryin' to give her was rest. She's been havin' it comfortably up at my ranch at Mendocino, with her children and me." "Yes, sir," his eye wandered accidentally to the new-made grave, "you'll excuse my sayin' it to a man in your profession, but it's what most folks will find is a heap better than readin' or writin' or actin' potry, and that's rest.